Hi guys, today in this class I am going to explain about the some overview concept about the entire carbohydrate metabolism. So before going to this video, you just go through the entire carbohydrate metabolism pathway. After that you can see this video, means it's very easy to recall and very easy to interrupt for your best understanding. So next I can go for the today's topic. As per your syllabus, we have seen so many pathways, example glycolysis and HMP pathway, and gluconeogenesis, glycogenesis, glycogenolysis, and some of the uncommon pathways like uranic acid pathways and sorbitol pathway, all those things. So in this class I am going to summarize all those pathways in single stretch in this hour. So first, as usual, we can go for the introduction. So in before going to the individual pathway, we know the what is the importance of glucose, because the glucose is one of the basic need molecule for energy purpose. Whatever we had, carbohydrate, fat material, our cell, each and every cell, it's need energy. That energy is supplied by the glucose. So the glucose is the last molecule, otherwise it's a central molecule for given energy. So in carbohydrate, we know that it's a polysaccharide, it's a best example for starch, then disaccharides, then various monosaccharides, glucose, fructose, galactose, so many things is there. But the glucose is the one of the predominant molecule for entering in metabolic pathway. Even we had fructose or galactose, it also is converted into the, finally it's converted into glucose molecule. So it's very, very important. In the same manner, the glucose, once its excess amount is there, means it's going to convert into the some other product. The example is, if it is more amount of glucose is there, means it's converted into the glycogen. At the same manner, it's entered into the pathway. In that pathway, particularly in TCA cycle, the acetyl-CoA is converted into the various process. So the same manner, the glucose is entered into the various pathway. It may produce some unique product. In meanwhile time, it's produced energy. That energy has been utilized for cell utilization. So first we can go, we can see what are the cycles there, what is the basic definition. First, glycolysis. The glycolysis is nothing but it's the oxidation of glucose process. So the glucose is the starting material, end product is pyruvate or lactate. The intermediately, the pyruvate or lactate is converted into the TCA cycle. In meanwhile, the pyruvate or lactate is converted into the acetyl-CoA. So that's an intermediate step. After that, the acetyl-CoA is entered into the citric acid cycle. That's it. That means TCA cycle. So it's an oxidation of acetyl-CoA. The acetyl-CoA is going to oxidize, is going given the more amount of energy. Then next process, gluconeogenesis process. What is this pathway means? This is the, in this pathway, the glucose molecule is going to synthesize from non-carbohydrate material. When we doesn't having glucose, that time from the non-carbohydrate material is going to synthesize the glucose molecule for the supply to cell. The next one is glycogenesis. The glycogenesis means formation of glycogen, that's all. Formation of glycogen from glucose. When we have excess amount of glucose, it's converted into the condensed form, that is glycogen. That synthesis of glycogen process called as glycogenesis. The same manner, WISA. When we doesn't having glucose, that time the stored glycogen is going to break down, it's going to produce more amount of glucose. That process is called as glycogenolysis. The next one is HMP pathway, otherwise is called as pentose phosphate pathway. So it's also same, it's oxidation of glucose process, but in this case the glucose molecule is converted into the ribose phosphate and fructose 6-phosphate. The ribose phosphate and xylose phosphate is having unique role. The particularly the ribose phosphate is essential for the synthesis of nucleotides during DNA replication cell cycle process. It acts as a nucleotide. So for those process, that pentose sugar is very, very essential. That pentose sugar is donated by from this pathway. Then uranic acid pathway, it's a process for synthesis of glucuronic acid and ascorbic acid. We know that the glucuronic acid is essential for the metabolism of various glucuronyl acid conjugation process. Ascorbic acid also is going to synthesize, but it may differ in some of the cases, particularly in humans, it's never going to synthesize. But in some species, it's going to synthesize. From this pathway, it's going to synthesize the ascorbic acid. Then as usual, we can go for the next one is galactose metabolism and fructose metabolism. then finally is going to synthesize some of the amino sugars. Because in our body, it's having various amino sugar molecules, glycoproteins, glycolipids, glucosamine. So it's all, each and everything is having some unique role. So those things is going to synthesize from this pathway. So whatever this entire pathway, it's connect with one and only molecule. That molecule is glucose. Okay. So next we can go for entry. Normally the glucose is enter into the blood circulation into two different mechanism. One is insulin dependent, another one is insulin independent transport system. Independent means in some places, example hepatocytes, erythrocytes, brain, in that place the insulin is not mandatory. Without insulin instruction, it's going to take the glucose, is going to utilize. But in some other place apart from this place, the glucose has been utilized, that's been transported by the glucose dependent transporter. Example, the glucose transporter GLUT. Various subtypes is there, so the each and every subtype is present on some different places. So it is going to work out when the insulin is give the signal. You can see here, so seven types of majorly the GLUT, seven types is there. So particularly the GLUT2 transporter is mostly it's present on the pancreas. So when the glucose molecule is transported from the extracellular into intracellular in beta cell, then only the beta cell is going to release the insulin. The same manner GLUT1, 3, 4, 5 and 6, it's present on the various places, is responsible for the transport of glucose from extracellular to intracellular. Next I can go for the first important cycle, glycolysis cycle. So the glycolysis cycle is otherwise is called as EMP pathway. So it is, we know that it's oxidation of glucose process. Normally this reaction is divided into three phases. First one is energy investment phase and splitting phase. The third one is energy generation phase. You can see this picture. So actually this is a 10 steps reaction. First step is glucose. The first step is glucose. The final step is pyruvate or lactate. So it's a 10 step reaction. In 10 step reactions has been divided into three different stages. First stage, energy investment phase, because in this step more amount of energy is going to involve in the reaction. That means it's going to donate for the reactions. The energy is donated by the ATP. Phosphorylation is going to happen. So ATP is given the phosphate group, then it's going to downregulate into ADP. So in second phase plus splitting phase, that molecule is going to split it into two substances. So then last phase, exactly the energy is going to generate in this phase only. So you can see here the glucose molecule. So in this out of 10 steps, three steps are irreversible steps. First one is glucose to glucose 6 phosphate conversion. It's done by the hexokinase enzyme or glucokinase enzyme. So this step is irreversible step. The second step is fructose 6 phosphate to fructose 1,6 phosphate. This is second step. This is also irreversible step in glycolysis. At last one, conversion of phosphoenol pyruvate into pyruvate. So these three steps are irreversible steps. Once the glucose is converted into the glucose 6 phosphate, it's never come back, otherwise never converted into the glucose in glycolysis step. But in gluconeogenesis process, these are the three steps that has been bypassed by some different mechanism. I can explain later. So this is the steps. The first one is glucose is converted into the glucose 6 phosphate with the help of hexokinase. Then it's converted into the fructose 6 phosphate with the help of isomerase enzyme. Then it's converted into second irreversible step, converted into fructose 1,6 biphosphate. Then it's going to split it into two compound, dihydroxyurea phosphate and glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate. Then further it's converted into the, then it's going to dehydrogenate, it's converted into the 1,3 biphosphoglycerate. Then further, kinase enzyme is going to involve, it's converted into the 3-phosphoglycerate, then 2-phosphoglycerate, then finally it's converted into the 3-phosphoenol, finally it's converted into the phosphoenol pyruvate. This phosphoenol pyruvate, it's converted into the, with the help of phosphofructokinase, is converted into the pyruvate. Then with the presence of lactate dehydrogenase enzyme, it's converted into the lactate. This is the 10-step reactions. So structure-wise, you can see here, the basic molecules, the mostly the 6-carbon atom I have divided into two different color pattern, blue color and green color. So first in energy investment phase, in two steps, the phosphorylation is going to happen. The first one is in sixth position, the phosphorylation is going to happen. So it is called as glucose 6 phosphate. Then it's going to isomerase. The hydroxyl group is going to isomerate. So then it's converted into fructose 6 phosphate. Then another one phosphorylation is going to happen in first position, so it's converted into the fructose 1,6 biphosphate. Then second phase is splitting phase. So the 6 carbon moiety is divided into 3 carbon moieties. One is dihydroacetone phosphate, the second one is glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate. Then this is further converted into 1,3 biphosphoglycerate with the dehydrogenase enzyme. So it's finally it's converted into 3 phosphoglycerate and 2 phosphoglycerate, and finally it's phosphoenol pyruvate with the help of various kinase and mutase enzyme. The last sub, phosphoenol pyruvate, it's converted into the pyruvate with the help of pyruvate kinase enzyme. Hereafter, the pyruvate, it may convert into the lactate with the presence of lactate dehydrogenase enzyme. So this is the overall reaction for glycolysis. So after that, after glycolysis, you can see here the glycogen is may break down into the glucose. Otherwise, the glucose is enter into the hexophosphate, 6 molecule phosphate. Then finally, it's converted into the pyruvate or lactate. It's going to produce free energy, carbon dioxide and water molecule. So for this process, the oxygen is very essential. So the presence of oxygen is going to catalyze the reactions. So once this pathway is happen, the pyruvate is converted into the keto form, then it's converted into the lactate with the help of lactate dehydrogenase enzyme. So in these steps, two enzymes is very responsible for this maintenance for regulation of glycolysis cycle. So one is fructose 2,6 biphosphatase, second one is pyruvate kinase. These two enzymes, enzymes is involved into the gluconeogenesis process also, because the fructose 6-phosphate to fructose 2,6 biphosphate conversion is done by the phosphofructokinase. Here the phosphatase enzyme, fructose 2,6 biphosphatase enzyme, it's convert the fructose 2,6 phosphate into fructose 6 phosphate. In this steps is involved in the gluconeogenesis process. The same manner in pyruvate kinase, we know that the pyruvate kinase is responsible for conversion of phosphoenol pyruvate to pyruvate. So the some of the in the same enzyme is going to involve in the gluconeogenesis also, because this enzymes has been activated or inactivated by with the help of protein kinase and phosphatase enzyme. So the phosphatase enzyme is responsible for activation of pyruvate kinase. So these are the things I can explain clearly on gluconeogenesis process. So the next cycle is TCA cycle, otherwise HEP cycle. So in first stage glycolysis cycle, we know that the glucose is converted into the pyruvate or lactate. So intermediately is converted into the acetyl CoA. The pyruvate is enter into the another pathway, intermediate pathway. It's converted into the acetyl CoA. So this acetyl CoA is a raw material for various pathway. So this acetyl CoA is enter into the TCA cycle. So it's going for various intermediate steps. It produces way more amount of energy process. So you can see here, this is the intermediate step. So the pyruvate, it's converted into the hydroxyethyl TPP, thiamine pyrophosphate. So actually the TPP is going to involve the reaction. So it's TPP is combined with pyruvate is converted into the hydroxyethyl tyrosine thiamine pyrophosphate. Then the dihydrolyphol transacetylase enzyme is going to donate the acetyl group. So it's converted into the acetyllyphomide. So that finally it's converted into the acetyl CoA. So the pyruvate, it's converted into the acetyl CoA. The same manner, pyruvate dehydrogenase enzyme also is involved in the various reactions, but no need to confuse about those enzymes in this stage. So you just to know the concept, the pyruvate, it's converted into the acetyl CoA. Now acetyl CoA is available. So now it's ready to enter into the TCA cycle. So in TCA cycle, you can see here the acetyl CoA, it's converted into the citrate. The two molecule of acetyl CoA is going to combine with the help of citrate synthase enzyme. It's converted into the citrate. Citrate is converted into the isocitrate. Intermediately is going to form a cis aconate with the help of aconitase enzyme. This isocitrate is converted into the alpha ketoglutarate, then succinyl CoA, succinate, fumarate, malate, then oxaloacetate. So this is a step. So intermediately the various enzymes, the isocitrate is converted into alpha ketoglutarate by dehydrogenase enzyme. Then it's once again is dehydrogenate, is converted into the succinyl CoA. Then succinyl CoA synthesis enzyme is responsible for the synthesis of succinate. Then further dehydrogenase into fumarate. Fumarate with the help of fumarase enzyme is converted into the malate. then maladehydrogenase is converted into the malate into oxaloacetate. So this is a reaction, TCA reaction. So structure wise you can see here, so structural difference, the two molecule of pyruvate is converted into the acetyl CoA. The two molecule of acetyl CoA is combined with the help of citrate synthase enzyme, it's converted into the citrate. So the citrate enzyme is converted into the isocitrate with the help of acetonitrase enzyme. So the isocitrate removal of carbon dioxide is going to remove the carbon dioxide, so it's converted into the alpha keto glutarate. The actually what's happened, dehydrogenase enzyme is carry out this reaction. So the next is acetyl coenzyme is involved, then removal of another one carbon dioxide, but the coenzyme is going to attach with the group, so it's become a succinyl CoA. The succinyl CoA is once again the coenzyme coenzyme has been removed, it's converted into the succinate. Then succinate dehydrogenase enzyme is going to remove the hydrogenation, and that means it's going to reduction, so remove the hydrogen molecule, it's converted into the fumarate. So with the presence of water molecule, then fumarase enzyme, it's converted into the malate. Then NADH is going to remove the hydrogen ions, it's going to convert into the oxaloacetates. So this is a cycle. So in this cycle, it's giving the more amount of energy. NADH is going to produce. So it's going to involve the various reactions. So the citric acid cycle is one of the major synthetic pathway for intermediates for various reactions. So you can see here from the oxaloacetate, the same thing, from the oxaloacetate the glucose is going to synthesis, it's may possible. The citrate is responsible for the fatty acid and sterol synthesis. From alpha ketoglutarate is going to transaminate, it's convert the glutamate productions. So succinyl CoA is responsible for production of heme protein. So from malate it's converted into the pyruvate, phosphoenol pyruvate. From the oxaloacetate also is possible. So the citric acid cycle is one of the hub, it's act as a hub. From this pathway, it may enter into the various sub-branches pathways. So the next one is gluconeogenesis. So the gluconeogenesis process, already I said that it's a formation of glucose from non-carbohydrate material. So the non-carbohydrate material may be the lactate or pyruvate, glycerol, propionate and some of the amino acids also. So this is a process. So mostly it's happen on the liver, particularly in cytosolic region and mitochondrial regions. So in this process, it's, in example, I have start with the pyruvate. So the pyruvate, it's converted into the oxaloacetate, then it's, and finally it's converted into the glucose. Once you can see this picture, it's simply, it's a reverse of glycolysis cycle. So in glycolysis, the glucose is converted into the pyruvate, but in gluconeogenesis process, the pyruvate is converted into the glucose. So you can see here, the amino acid, or lactate, otherwise a glycerol molecule, it's converted into the glucose. That means the gluconeogenesis process started from the bottom to top. So for the difference in the glycolysis and gluconeogenesis process, you can see this picture. So the red color, pink color is denoted as the glycolysis cycle. The blue color is going to denote the gluconeogenesis process. So in this process, I already say that the three important steps. First step, glucose to glucose 6-phosphate, then fructose 6-phosphate to fructose 1,6-phosphate, then finally phosphoenol pyruvate to pyruvate. So these are the three steps are irreversible step in glycolysis. So these are the three pathways has been overcome by some different unique enzymes for gluconeogenesis process. As I said earlier, the gluconeogenesis process have three obstacles. So the three steps has been actually irreversible steps. These are the three steps has been bypassed by some different unique mechanism. So you can see here, this is the exact pathway for differentiating glycolysis and gluconeogenesis process. From the top to bottom, it's a glycolysis cycle. From the bottom to top, it's a gluconeogenesis process. So the three intermediate steps has been bypassed. First one is glucose to glucose 6-phosphate, fructose 6-phosphate to fructose 1,6-phosphate, then phosphoenol pyruvate to pyruvate conversion. So these are the three steps has been bypassed. So what's exactly happened means, yeah, these are the three steps. What's exactly is bypassed means, first step, the pyruvate into phosphoenol pyruvate. It is very tough. Further process, the pyruvate is, it's enter into the some of the unique pathway in mitochondria. So the pyruvate is enter into the mitochondria, it's converted into the various steps. Finally, it's converted into the malate. So the pyruvate is converted into the oxaloacetate keto, exact same like is a TCA cycle. So the same thing is going to happen from the malate. It's the malate, it's easily cross the mitochondrial membrane because the oxaloacetate it can't cross the mitochondrial membrane. So the malate it's easily cross. So in the malate it's coming out from the mitochondria, then it, in cytosolic region it's converted into the oxaloacetate. From the oxaloacetate it's converted into the phosphoenol pyruvate. So the first steps has been bypassed. So the same thing, the glycolysis is going to reverse the same manner. From the phosphoenol pyruvate it's converted into the 2-phosphoglycerate, 3-phosphoglycerate, 1,3-biphosphoglycerate, then glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, then converted into the fructose 1,6-phosphate. Here another one problem is there, because the fructose conversion of fructose 1,6-phosphate to fructose 6-phosphate is irreversible steps in glycolysis. So here the phosphatase enzyme, fructose 1,6-phosphatase enzyme, it's going to dephosphorylate the 1-phosphate group, then it's converted into the fructose 6-phosphate. Then once again it's converted into the glucose 6-phosphate, that's easily converted. Here the next one is another one problem, because the glucose 6-phosphate to glucose conversion is also irreversible. Here also the same, glucose 6-phosphate phosphatase enzyme responsible for dephosphorylating phosphate group from the 6th position, so it's converted into the glucose molecule. So that's the overall gluconeogenesis process. Three obstacles has been bypassed by some unique three enzymes. So after that, some of the regulators is going to control the gluconeogenesis process. Example, the glucagon and insulin and the glucocorticoids and availability of the substrate, some of the acetyl-CoA. So these various substances going to control the gluconeogenesis process. So the next we have seen algal, it's one of the important concept here. Algal is going to inhibit the gluconeogenesis process because the algal is converted into the acetaldehyde. For those process, the more amount of NADH is going to form. So the NADH is formed means it's going to bind with the, our substrate, either pyruvate or lactate. It's converted into the other product. The pyruvate is converted into the lactate, oxaloacetate, it's converted into the malate. So whenever we have consumed algal, it's produced more amount of NADH. The NADH is present means the pyruvate, the substrate, it's converted into the product. The pyruvate is converted into the lactate, so no raw material is there, so it's never entered into the gluconeogenesis process. In the same manner, the oxaloacetate with the presence of NADH is converted into the malate. So we have lose the raw material, so the gluconeogenesis process is going to inhibit. So what's the thing is that it's going to inhibit the gluconeogenesis process means the net results is produce a hypoglycemic effect. At the same manner, the algal is going to directly inhibit the TPP, thymine pyrophosphate. So from that mechanism also is going to inhibit the blood glucose level. The same manner, the algal is going to inhibit the thymine mediated glucose utilization purpose. So for because of the net results is going to produce the hypoglycemic effect. Next we are going to see about the glycogenesis. So the glycogenesis, we know that it's a condensed form of glucose, but when we have excess amount of glucose, it has been converted into the glycogen. The process, the synthesis process called as glycogenesis. It acts as a fuel reservoir. When we need energy, instant energy, that time the glycogen is going to break down, it's produce more amount of glucose. So whenever we have a glucose, it's going to convert into the reservoir. So the glycogenesis is the same thing. The glucose is converted into the glycogen, condensed form. So individual steps, again we can see here. So the first glucose molecule is going to attach with the UDP molecule. So yeah, UDP glucose is converted into the UDP glucose. Then UDP glucose is going to attach one by one. It's going to attach. It's a linear chain with the help of glycogen synthase enzyme with the presence of glycogen in primer, either fragment of glycogen, otherwise glycogenin. So when the presence of the glycogen in primer or glycogen, otherwise when the presence of glycogenin or glycogen fragment, then glycogen synthesis, it's going to addition of UDP glucose. So it's going to forming a linear chain. So the linear chain is once again is going to break. It's going to form a sub branch chain. So it's going to form a condensed form. UDP glucose is going to condense. So it's going to arrange more and more number of UDP glucose it's around more than 60,000 of glycosylation is going to the contents, so it's becoming a glycogen. Okay, so the steps are divided into four phases. The first one is synthesis of UDP glucose, then primary initiation with the glycogenesis initiation with primer. So third one is glycogen synthesis with the help of glycogen synthase enzyme. The finally it's a formation of branches. So first one is the glucose molecule is converted into the glucose 6 phosphate and 1 phosphate. Then with the help of UDP glucose phosphorylase enzyme, UDP is going to attach with the glucose. It's becoming a UDP glucose. That is the first step. Glucose is converted into the UDP glucose with the help of UDP glucose pyrophosphorylase enzyme. So the next one is initiation of glycogen synthesis with presence of glycogen fragment, small amount of fragment, otherwise glycogen primer. With the presence of this substance, then along with that glycogen synthase enzyme and UDP glucose is going to attach one by one in 1,6 glycosidic linkage. So the chain is become linear. So it's going to chain elongation is going to happen. So the second one is, this is exactly phase. The presence of glycogen synthase enzyme, the UDP molecule, the primer is ready. So the glucose molecule is one by one is going to attach with the primer. So it's becoming a linear chain. So the chain is going to elongate. So after that, in fourth step, the chain elongation is going to 1,6 alpha, 1,6 glycosidic linkage is going to happen. So the chain is become linear elongation. So the chain breakage is going to happen. So that means the elongation of chain is break. Then the same chain is going to attach with alpha 1,6 bond with sub branches. So the linear chain break and is going to attach with like a sub branch. So then only it's become condensed. So the cycle is going to continue. So it's going to form a more and more amount of linear chain, then side branch. So it's become a condensed form of glycogen. That's a concept. So the next one is glycogenolysis. So we know that it's a degradation of glycogen into glucose. When our body need glucose, when we doesn't having food material, that time our body needs some glucose molecule for basal metabolic purpose. So for that case, the first is stored glycogen is going to break down. It is break down into the free glucose. That free glucose is going to involve for various purpose, energy utilization purpose. You can see here, this is glucose to glycogen is glycogenesis process. The genolysis process, the glycogen is going to break down into glucose molecule. The glucose 1,6 phosphate, then it's converted into the glucose 6 phosphate, then finally it's going to become a glucose molecule. So this is a overall summarization for both the glycogenesis and the glycogenolysis process. Here the overall reaction has been divided into three steps. The first one is action of glycogen phosphorylase enzyme. The second one is debranching. The fourth one is conversion of glucose 6 phosphate into glucose. So as far as we know, first step is going to for glycogen phosphorylase. That means the linear chain. First, we know that the glycogen is having a linear chain with the attachment of various sub branches. So the linear chain is going to it's going to remove by alpha 1,6 glycosidic linkage. So this is a 1,6 linkage. So one by one, the UDP molecule is going to remove. So up to the remaining of four molecules. So that when it's having a four molecule, it's called as limit dextrin. So simply the phosphorylase enzyme is going to remove the one molecule. So it's going to remain four molecule. Up to it's going to remain the four molecule means it is called as limit dextrin. So otherwise, for remove the one glucose molecule up to become a limit dextrin. So once the limit dextrin is formed means the second step is going to there. That's a debranching enzyme. So in debranching process, so we know that in glycogen is having a linear chain, then sub branches. So from the branches is going to remove the branch chain except one glucose molecule. So it's going to leave only one molecule. The remaining glucose molecules is going to break. Then it's going to arrange with the linear chain. So sub branch is going to cut. It's going to attach with linear chain. So remaining only one glucose molecule is going to available in alpha 1,6 bond. So then next is that only one remaining glucose molecule also is going to debranch. So it's going to produce one glucose molecule as a free molecule. So this branching debranching process called as alpha 1,6 glycosidase activity. So 1,4 linkage, 1,6 linkage is going to remove, means it's going to produce one glucose molecule. What the problem is there, the glucose molecule is a, not a free glucose. It's glucose, it's a phosphorylated glucose molecule. So it's available in the glucose 1 phosphate. Then with the help of phosphoglucomutase, is converted into the glucose 6 phosphate. Then with the help of phosphatase enzyme, it's going to dephosphorylate the phosphate group from the 6 position of glucose. Now the glucose is ready as a free form. So the glucose is directly involved into the energy utilization purpose. Otherwise, from the glucose 6 phosphate, it's entered into the glycolysis cycle for the energy production purpose. So for this entire steps, glycogenolysis or glycogen synthesis, glycogenesis, it's controlled by the various substances, particularly the glucose 6 phosphatase and ATP, liver glucose. These are the things is going to give the negative feedback signal for the conversion of glycogen into glycogen phosphate. That means it's going to inhibit the glycogen phosphorylase enzyme. That enzyme is responsible for breakdown of glycogen into glycogen phosphate. So that means breakdown of glucose is going to control by these are the substances, because when it's having sufficient amount of glucose or energy or glucose 6 phosphate, what is the need for breakdown? So it's directly is going to inhibit the breakdown of glycogen. But the same steps has been initiated by the muscle, cyclic AMP, otherwise calcium ions. When the muscle is need energy, that glucose, that time it's going to stimulate that enzyme. That enzyme is going to phosphorylate the glycogen into glucose 1 phosphate, energy utilization purpose. The same thing here, the conversion of glucose into glycogen conversion, glycogenesis process is going to stimulate by the glucose 6 phosphate. When we have excess amount of glucose 6 phosphate, itself is going to stimulate the glycogen synthase enzyme for the conversion of glucose into glycogen. So this is a regulation. So as far as we know that some of the hormones, particularly the glucagon and the epinephrine, simply you can understand the end result, net result is we want it's increase the blood glucose level. Blood glucose level means we want increase, means it's going to promote the glycogenolysis process. Otherwise we can go into inhibit the gluconeogenesis process two way. We want to increase the glucose level, either to promote the glycogenolysis, breakdown of glycogen. Otherwise, inhibit the gluconeogenesis process. Inhibit the glycogenesis process. So, whenever the substance, the epinephrine or glucagon, these are the substances going to attach with the receptor, it's going to activate the adenine cyclase pathway. So, internal cyclic AMP is going to stimulate the cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase is going to activate. So, it's going to induce the deactivation process, is going to inactivate the glycogen synthase enzyme. That means the glucose is never converted into the glycogen. So automatically we can make available of glucose. That's a one mechanism. In other mechanism, the same thing, cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase is activate, means is going to activate the glycogen phosphorylase enzyme. We know that enzyme is responsible for conversion of glycogen into glucose 6 phosphate. So the net result here is automatically the glucose level is going to increase. So these are the things is going to regulate the glucose level by either promote the glycogenolysis or inhibit the glycogen synthesis process. So the next one is HMP pathway. So as far as we know that first glucose is entered into the glycolysis, then TCA cycle, then it's converted into the glycogenesis or glycogenolysis. Then parallelly the HMP shunt, otherwise pentose phosphate pathway is another one pathway for glucose oxidation process. In this process, this is essential for production of pentose phosphate. The pentose phosphate, 5-phosphate, it's essential for the formation of nucleotides for DNA replication process or cell cycle process. The primer, the base pair is going to attach. The base pair is consist of it's called as nucleotide. It's having a nitrogenase base and one phosphate group, then one pentose sugar molecule. So the pentose sugar molecule is nothing but ribose 5-phosphate. That ribose 5-phosphate has been synthesized by this HMP shunt. So we can go for exact this pathway. This is the overview things. The glucose molecule is converted into the 6-phosphogluconolactone, then gluconate, then ribulose 5-phosphate. From the ribulose 5-phosphate, it's converted into the xylose 5-phosphate and otherwise converted into the ribose 5-phosphate. Then it's enter into the further cycle. So I can give the simple concept. It's divided into two phases, oxidative phase and non-oxidative phase. So the oxidative phase, this one is non-oxidative phase. You can see here, the glucose molecule is converted into the gluconolactone, then 6-phosphogluconolactone, then it's converted into the ribulose 5-phosphate. The ribulose 5-phosphate, it's responsible for formation of ribose 5-phosphate. This is pentose sugar. This is essential for formation of nucleotide. So apart from that, with the help of transketolase enzyme, it's converted into the xylose 5-phosphate. Then once again, it's entered into the reaction with the help of transketolase enzyme. It's converted into the fructose 6-phosphate and erythrose 4-phosphate and glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. So these are the each and everything is having unique function. Erythrose 4-phosphate is essential to maintain the RBC stability. And fructose 6-phosphate, as far as we know that it's entered into the glycolysis cycle for the production of energy, inflation purpose. Ribose 5-phosphate is essential for the nucleotide formation. So the HMP shunt or pentose phosphate pathway is responsible for having this unique function. When the patients, any persons having alteration of this transketolase enzyme, it's called as Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrom. It's some kind of a psychotic disturbance is there. So actually it's a Wernicke encephalopathy and Korsakoff syndrome. Because of two things, is one is lack of transketolase enzyme, the second one is interference of thymine pyrophosphate, that's essential for the acetyl-CoA formation. So because of that, it's going to produce encephalopathy, Wernicke encephalopathy. It's like a psychotic behavior. It's the syndrome is called as Korsakoff syndrome. So what's the reason? Because of this inhibition, transketolase inhibition, otherwise TBP inhibition, means the brain, it can't able to get the energy. The glucose is not at all is going to metabolize in brain. So in brain is not getting sufficient amount of energy. It's lead to the necrosis of neurons. It's the reason for this effect. So next we can go for the other important metabolic pathway. So first one is uric acid pathway. It's having a four steps. First is a formation of UDP glucuronate. The second one is UDP glucuronate into L-gulonate, then ascorbic acid. From the L-gulonate, it's divided into two steps. One is ascorbic acid synthesis, another one is xylose 5-phosphate synthesis. So I can give the pictorial representation for these four steps. So first one is, as far as I said, the glucose 6-phosphate is converted into the UDP glucuronate. The same thing, what we have seen in gluconeogenesis, the same manner UDP glucose is going to attach, is become a UDP glucuronate. That is the first step. In second step, the UDP glucose molecule, it's converted into the D-glucuronate with the help of UDP glucuronate dehydrogenase. Then D-glucuronate, it's further converted into the L-glucuronate. So the L-glucuronate, it's converted into the ascorbic acid. That's a third step. L-glucuronate, it's converted into the L-ascorbic acid. The parallelly, the same L-glucuronate, it's entered into the parallelly other steps. It's responsible for the formation of xylose 5-phosphate. So L-glucuronate is converted into the L-xylose, xylitol and D-xylose. Then finally, xylose 5-phosphate, it's entered into the hexose HMP pathway. So this uric acid pathway is very, very essential. As far as we know that, it's essential for glucuronyl acid conjugation process for metabolic. Most of the drugs is metabolized by the glucuronyl conjugation process. For that process, the glucuronic acid is synthesized by this pathway. The parallelly ascorbic acid synthesis also is going to happen in some species. So the next one is metabolism of galactose. So the galactose is converted into the galactitol. One is first one is converted into the galactitol with the help of aldose reductase enzyme. Then with the help of same as hexokinase, galactokinase is converted into the galactose 1-phosphate. Then UDP glucose transferase enzyme is transfer the UDP molecule. So the galactose is converted into the UDP galactose. Glucose is donated, it's converted into the glucose 1-phosphate. So the same thing is going to convert. The UDP galactose, it's responsible for the formation of UDP glucose. The next glucose 1 phosphate, it's converted into the glucose 6 phosphate, then it's enter into the glycolysis cycle. The parallelly, the UDP galactose, it's converted into the either lactose and glucosamines. As far as we said, the amino sugars, this the UDP glucose is responsible for the formation of glycolipids and some glycoproteins also. The next is metabolism of fructose. The fructose with the presence of hexokinase enzyme, it's converted into the fructose 6 phosphate. So the sorbitol is made converted into the fructose with the help of sorbitol dehydrogenase enzyme. The same fructose is made converted into the sorbitol also. It's like a reversible reactions. So once the fructose is converted into the either sorbitol or fructose 6 phosphate, means the next step is the fructose from the fructose 6 phosphate, it's converted into the glucose 6 phosphate, then glycogen. Then glycogen is further is converted into the glucose molecule by glycogenolysis process. That glucose is converted into the sorbitol by sorbitol pathway with the help of aldose reductase enzyme. Both glucose and galactose with the help of aldose reductase enzyme, it's converted into the either sorbitol, otherwise xylitol. So this is a step. Then next, after that, the fructose molecule, otherwise directly it's converted into the fructose 1 phosphate with the help of fructokinase. Then fructose 1,6 phosphate is converted into the glyceraldehyde, then glycerol. From this glyceraldehyde, then it's going to produce some other product, that is dihydroxyacetone phosphate. So the same thing is involved for the some other process. The glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate is converted into the glycerol. So intermediately with the help of triokinase is converted into the glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate. So once the glycerol is available, means the glycerol kinase is converted into the glycerol into glycerol 3 phosphate. It's a responsible steps for the synthesis of triglycerols and the phospholipids. So the net results is going to synthesize the lipids. The glycerol 3 phosphate is further dehydrogenase is converted into the DHAP, dihydroacetone phosphate. So this DHAP and glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate, we already know that in glycolysis cycle, the both the DHAP and the glyceraldehyde 3 phosphates enter into the glycolysis cycle. So this is overall things. In sorbitol polyol pathway, same thing as far as I said, when the excess amount of glucose is there with the presence of aldose reductase enzyme, it's converted into the sorbitol. If it is glucose, means it's converted into the sorbitol. Galactose means it's converted into the xylitol. So normally this is happening is the aldose reductase enzyme, it's mostly present on the some specific places, particularly in neuron, nerve, peripheral tissues, erythrocytes, lens, and seminal vesicles. So once the glucose is converted into the sorbitol, means the sorbitol itself is going to stuck with that place itself because it can't able to cross the place. It's not coming out from the place. So the sorbitol is going to accumulate, it's lead to complications. If it is lens, means more amount of sorbitol is going to accumulate, it's becoming a cataract. If it is nerve or neurons means it's becoming a neuropathy. Nephron means it's going to nephropathy. It's going to damage the things. So that's the reason, the sorbitol pathway is the exact reason for the microvascular and macrovascular complications. The same thing, the fructose is converted into the sorbitol. The same thing, sorbitol is converted into the fructose with the help of sorbitol dehydrogenase enzyme. The only thing is useful place is seminal vesicle. In seminal vesicles, it's going to utilize, mostly it's going to utilize the fructose, not glucose. For stem cell is going to utilize the fructose. So that fructose molecule is gained from the sorbitol because it's a seminal vesicle is having a sorbitol dehydrogenase enzyme. So the sorbitol is converted into the fructose with the help of those enzymes. The fructose is utilized for the stem cell. So that's a thing. In diabetic condition, as far as I say, the same thing. So excess amount of glucose, it's converted into the sorbitol, it's going to become a stuck on the place itself, it's going to become a microvascular, macrovascular complications in based upon the places, different places. Whether this high fructose consumption is a risk, yes, it's a risk because it's lead to the lipogenesis process. Because the fructose metabolism, we know that it's finally it's converted into the glycerol is converted into the formation of triacylglycerol and phospholipids, so it's lead to the atherosclerosis. High consumption of fructose is also a risk. Nowadays in diabetic patients, mostly they have think instead of glucose they want to take a fructose. It's available in the market also, but it's high risk. When compared to the glucose, the fructose is high risk for the becoming a cardiovascular patients. So the next one is amino sugar synthesis. So as far as we know that last, it's glucose is one of the basic raw material for the production of glycosamines. That means amino sugars also. So the glucose molecule is converted into the various intermediate steps. With the help of glycosamines, it's converted into the glycosamine 6-phosphate. Then it's converted into the glycosaminoes. So then next one is acetylated by the acetyl-CoA. N-acetyl glycosamine 6-phosphate is going to responsible for the various steps. It's going to finally form some glycoproteins. Parallelly, from the acetylated glycosamine, it's converted into the glycoprotein with the help of epimerase enzyme. Acetyl UDP molecule is going to attach together. So it's converted into the glycoprotein. So it's glycosamine is going to synthesize glycoproteins and glycanes. It's going to synthesize by this amino sugars. So this is the responsible things. So the last one is glyoxylate cycle. Normally, you just understand this cycle because the glyoxylate cycle is never happen in the humans. The cycle is very interesting thing because it's mostly happen in the plants. So what is this exact cycle means? From the fatty acid glucose synthesis. Normally in humans, the glucose is synthesized from either glycogen and some other material. In plants, particularly in seed, when it's going to germinate, the seed is having high amount of steroids. So when it's under the propagation, so during germination process, the steroids has been converted into the carbohydrate glucose molecule for the germination process. How it's happened means this exactly the glyoxylate cycle is going to happen on that seed. So the fatty acid is converted into the acetyl-CoA. Once acetyl-CoA is there, means we know that it is entered into the TCA cycle. So in TCA cycle, intermediately, acetyl-CoA is converted into the citrate, then it's converted into the isocitrate. The isocitrate is enter into the continuing means is going to the same TCA cycle. But this isocitrate is converted into the succinate, then glyoxylate. With the help of isocitrate lyase enzyme, it's converted into the glyoxylate product. That glyoxylate is converted into the malate. So this step is happen on only on seeds in plants. So it's very, very essential for energy utilization from the fat resources. So that's a cycle. So that's all. So as last, glucose tolerance test and galactose tolerance test. So the glucose tolerance test is useful for the determine the whether person is a diabetic or pre-diabetic, otherwise severe diabetic condition. So in oral glucose tolerance test, nothing but you are going to determine the whether the person is a diabetic or pre-diabetic, otherwise severe diabetic condition. In this case, simple, the person is allowed to fasting for 8 to 12 hours. The next day morning, we have collected the blood samples, check whether the patient blood glucose level. That's considered as zero blood glucose level, zero time. So after that, we can give you the measured amount of glucose powder with the otherwise solutions. with the consuming with the some specific time, within 5 minutes, the person is consuming 75 grams of glucose. After that, with the period of interval, half an hour or 1 hour, we are going to withdraw the blood sample and check the blood glucose level. Based upon that, after 2 hours, we are going to make a conclusion. Based upon the blood glucose level, we are determining that the person is really tolerate with glucose, whether the person is diabetic or pre-diabetic, otherwise severe diabetic conditions. Below 100 means okay, 100 to 125 means impair, more than 125 means diabetic in fasting level. So after consumption of oral glucose level, after 2 hours, the blood glucose level is more than 140 means it's just indicate hyperglycemia. The person is okay, it's due to the excess of glucose, the hyperglycemic condition is there. So the person is not diabetic, okay, clear. The person blood glucose level is more than 140 to 200 means it's an indication for the person is impaired with glucose. If more than 200 means the person is pre-diabetic. So from this test, we can clearly say the person is diabetic or not. So the next one is galactose tolerance test. So this test is going to simply determine the whether person is tolerate with galactose or not, because the galactose is must be converted into the some other product, lactose, otherwise in xylitol product. So it must be converted. If it is not converted, mean we can say that the person is having galactose tolerance. So here also the same manner, the galactose is given by two method, either oral or IV. So the oral method, the elimination, the entire amount of glucose, the 3 gram of galactose has been in urine within 5 hours. It indicates means they are having liver damage. In intravenous method, the galactose should be eliminated within 45 minutes. So it's never happened means we can say it's having some impairment of metabolic process of galactose. So next, I can give you the quick rewind for the complete things. So first, we know that the glycolysis, the glucose is converted into the lactate. It's from the lactate or pyruvate, it's enter into the intermediate step, is converted into the acetyl-CoA. The acetyl-CoA is enter into the TCA cycle. The TCA cycle is going to conversion of combine and combination of acetyl-CoA. It's going to combine citrate, isocitrate, alpha-ketoglutarate, and succinate and fumarate, malate. So intermediate is going to produce various enzymes. This is TCA cycle. Parallelly, the excess amount of glucose is there means it's going undergoing the when excess amount of glucose is means is enter into the glycogenesis process. That means the glucose molecule is going to condense, it's becoming a glycogen. The stored glycogen is when we are starving, that time it's going to break down, means it's called as glycogenolysis. The parallelly, the HMP strand, pentose phosphate pathway, it's another one oxidation, glucose oxidation pathway. In this case, the glucose molecule is going to produce the ribose phosphate, erythrose 4-phosphate, and fructose 6-phosphate, ribulose 5-phosphate. These are the things is having unique function. Example, ribose 5-phosphate is essential for the nucleotide formation. Fructose phosphate means it enter into the glycolysis cycle. It's the same thing. The ribose is enter into the nucleotide. Xylose is converted into the glyceraldehyde fructose. It's enter into the glycolysis step. Erythrose 4-phosphate is maintain the stability of the RBC cells. So this is each and everything is going to in the individual action. The next one is gluconeogenesis process. That means formation of glucose molecule. The same thing is lactate or pyruvate is going to act as a starting material. From this is going to form a glucose molecule. Means it's called as gluconeogenesis process. So this is the next one, complete glucose metabolism. So you can see here, the glucose molecule, this is a starting material. The glucose molecule is converted into the glucose 6-phosphate, fructose 6-phosphate. Then it's converted into the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, then phosphoenolpyruvate, pyruvate. So from here to here, this is a glycolysis. So from here to there, that is called as gluconeogenesis process. After that, the phosphoenolpyruvate, pyruvate conversion is converted into the acetyl-CoA by intermediate steps. Then finally, it's entered into the TCA cycle, means it's called as citric acid cycle or TCA cycle. So here the ethanol is going to interfere the reactions. The same manner, the mannose or galactose or fructose, it's also is involved the reactions. The galactose is converted into the galactose 1-phosphate and UDP glucose is converted, the things is converted into the responsible for the glycogen synthesis. So the galactose is involved for the lactate synthesis also. So the from the galactose is going to synthesize the glycogen. From this pathway, the glycogen is going to breakdown when our body needs a glucose molecule. So from this is going to act. The mannose is converted into the mannose 6-phosphate, it's converted into the fructose 6-phosphate, it's enter into the glycolysis steps. Fructose, as far as we know that, fructose is converted into the fructose 1-phosphate, it's converted into the sorbitol, it's converted into the arthrosclerosis, glycerol pathway, it's enter into, it's going for glycerol synthesis, then it's converted into the phospholipids and triglycerides formation is responsible for the occurrence of arthrosclerosis. The parallelly, the fructose 6-phosphate is going to produce the DHAP and the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. The both the things is same thing is enter into the glycolysis cycle. So this is a overall carbohydrate metabolic pathway in single slide. So thank you. Here itself I can wind up the session. So in next class we can see some other topic. Thank you. Sign out.